Observation one, the resolution one else is the resolution is U.S. federal government should grant the president trade promotion authority. That second argument right here is going to be a policy debate seen through the lens of net benefits. Observation two's background. The first argument is the TPA is inevitable in the status quo with the new Senate. The little later here is the top of the GOP docket in 2015 has been giving the president trade promotion authority. The next argument right here is that the incoming chair, Orrin Hatch, also said that he wants to be able to grant this. But the next argument right here is that Obama also wants this because it gives it fast tracks the ability to get a straight up and down vote on trade on trade agreements and helps manufacturing choose who wants a diploma like this too. Plain text. The U.S. federal government, through an act of Congress, should grant the President Trade Promotion Authority. The U.S. federal government, through an act of Congress, should give the President Trade Promotion Authority.
Okay.
It's the Reds, yeah. Advantage one is manufacturing. The Asian is the first argument is the auto industry is declining right now. The little end here is manufacturing is down in the auto industry about 1.3% in the last quarter. But the second argument here is they have had a third straight month of manufacturing and purchasing decreases in the auto industry. The next argument here is that vehicle prices have also increased by 5%. This has massively decreased the type of demand that is needed for the auto industry to continue to thrive. But the last argument here is that decreased sales of over 1 million units in December showed that the auto industry is very much on a downturn. But the next argument here is vehicle recalls of over 2 million in the last couple of years has massively decreased the demand because people are afraid of buying cars that are going to blow up in their face. Second argument here is manufacturing manufacturing is also, but on the other hand, manufacturing is looking positive due to the TTIP, the little landers. The US and EU US and EU trade would equal over 1% increase in GDP for the EU and the United States. But the next argument under here is the TTIP signage would increase trade to the EU, which is specifically important because the EU buys a lot of the US manufacturing goods, especially when it comes to new types of manufacturing in terms of computers and automobiles. Oh, so yeah, sorry, what's up?
Yeah, the TTIP, what's your estimate on like when that's gonna go through?
Our estimate post plan is that it would go through a lot faster because the president would have trade promotion authority. These links. The first argument is that the trade promotion authority is key to manufacturing the little energy. This gives the Obama fast track ability to be able to increase trade because he's able to pass trade agreements and get a straight up and down vote. But the next argument here is Obama specifically would want to increase trade agreements because it is key to increasing jobs because the more that we're sending out to other countries, the more jobs that we have here. But the next argument here is that businesses will also want this because the manufacturing sector is a huge chunk of businesses in the United States, which means the GOP also really likes this. The second argument here is regional free trade is key to manufacturing exports. The little energies, lower tariffs, and synchronized investment between two different regions means that these two different regions are going to be depending on each other for specific goods, specifically manufacturing goods, and this is always going to increase manufacturing in that specific country. But the next argument is free trade agreement signed with Korea, Panama, and Colombia all resulted in over a 10% increase in exports back in 2010. Seize the interlinks. The first argument is that manufacturing is key to the U.S. economy. The little lander here is that the multiplier effect of manufacturing is one of the highest in the country. Every $1 put into manufacturing equals $1.48 that comes out of manufacturing. The next argument under here is that manufacturing also increases the amount of jobs, one, because people need those jobs to manufacture, but also the type of jobs transporting the manufactured goods and people buying and selling the manufactured goods always creates an increase in jobs. The next argument under here is that manufacturing also increases the standard of living. We noted that there was an over 50% increase in standard of living in the United States from 2000 to 2010 when manufacturing was booming. The second argument here is manufacturing is key for a stable economy. The whole argument is the Labor Department rates manufacturing as the highest employment values, and individuals in the manufacturing industry are always going to have jobs that are much more secure, much more stable, and high paying. DC index. The first argument here is that unemployment and poverty are bad for a couple of reasons. The first argument is that poverty kills over 291,000 people a year in the United States alone. But the next argument is that unemployment lowers life expectancy by 50% and also increases the risk of things like heart attack and cancer by over 25%. The next argument here is that U.S. manufacturing is decreased, but all linked to a global economic decrease. The next argument here is that the U.S. is the largest economy in the world, and also that what happens to the U.S. manufacturing has a spillover effect to the global economy. We can note to 2008 when manufacturing. The Great Recession led to an overall decrease in the manufacturing sector in the United States. It led to an overall decrease in the global economy. That means that we have spillover impacts to the rest of the globe. Advantage two, power projection. Asia's first argument is U.S. image around the world is decreasing a little under here. So Obama went to Asia in November to be able to start pacifying Asian Pacific allies that are a little under here. The next argument under here is uncertainty increases in China. Australia signed a trade agreement showing that they are starting to move away from the United States. The second argument is U.S. smart power is decreasing. America's traditional allies, France and Britain, are all slipping down the economic ranks for more newer powers like Brazil and Turkey. The line here specifically showed that the U.S. is losing its hegemony in regions that it previously controlled. Specifically, you know, that Turkey and Brazil voted against the United States for Iranian sanctions in 2012, which shows a decrease in U.S. hegemony overall. The weakest link to the first argument is that regional trade increases power protection. This shores up allies because it creates dependency on the two nations because they're trading with those two different regions. The next argument over here is the TPP would increase ties to the Asia Pacific allies. The second argument over here is regional free trade increases basing rights. Economic alliances eventually turned into military alliances. We noticed that the EU trade agreements led to with their Nordic allies created a military alliance between those two regions. But the second argument right here that we noticed that regional trade agreements with Latin America has increased U.S. basic rights in those areas. So in turn, like the first argument is U.S. power can just keep it protecting against the Malacca Strait. The little areas of the TPP includes Malaysia and Singapore, who are the two countries that surround the strait. The second argument is this key bet to check back against Russia and Germany. Russia has threatened to threaten Moldova on many different occasions, and Russia has also recently invaded the Ukraine. The next argument under here is that if Russia sees the Malacca Strait as key to its economic growth, decreasing the impact. The first argument is an attack on the Malacca Strait equals oil spikes and food shortages. The oil emitters take traffic increased by three times that of the Suez Canal and five times that of the Panama Canal, which means that 1/4 of the world's oil is being put in danger, and 1/4 of a lot of the food is being put in danger too. Let's try.
It is going to be 2 off, and then it's going to be on in order. Is everyone ready?
Yep.
Awesome. The first off is going to be a disadvantage of the TPA. The A is going to be uniqueness. What is that? Trade agreements over and power corporations. The little A is that you can see the TPP chapter on intellectual property rights, specifically that was leaked through WikiLeaks, showed several different patent law changes, which will extend the ability for corporations to abuse patent laws. A few examples of this is that they'll allow patents for different forms of pills. So they'll allow for the gel pill, they'll allow for like powder pills, they'll allow for liquid types, and this allows them to extend the life. The second point here is that they'll allow patents for the use of for new uses of existing products, which means that they can just continue extending the use. The third way that they can do this is by granting damages for patent infringements up to 3 times the injury. So if they lose $1, they can charge you for 3, or like this is on a more drastic scale when we're talking about Big Pharma. But these are just 3 ways that they can drastically extend patent rights. Second argument here is that the FTA includes the ISDS clause, which basically allows corporations to sue local governments for laws infringing on profits. We can look to Costa Rica, who was sued for 3 times their GDP when they were drilling off the offshores. They tried to stop them because of environmental protection, and the corporation came in and sued them, and it was ruled in favor of the corporation because of free trade agreements and the ISDS clause that allows them to do this. Links that the plan passes in UN TPA to the president. The internal link here is that one TPA will pass free trade agreements. you can send their analysis that this will pass. The TPP, we'll be talking about the TTIP later, but specifically the TPP is the one that has the medical access cut off. The lay here is that Obama wants TPA specifically for the TPP, and negotiations are basically wrapping up, which means that they can pass this extremely quickly because the negotiations are almost done. The lay here is that all you need is a majority for this to pass, and with the midterm elections, Republicans have a majority in both houses, which means that it will be extremely swift. The second here is that this cuts global access to medicine. The lay here is that drug companies can challenge any restraint, and basically they can challenge any restraint on their ability to raise prices. There is literally nothing limiting them on the prices. This includes laws of power that empower Medicare and Medicaid, meaning that those medications will be jacked up in price. Additionally, this gives full autonomy to Big Pharma on prices because there's not going to be any generic competition, which means that they have the ability to charge whatever they want. The little B here is that Susan Sell, a professor and researcher on George Washington University, specifically looked at the TPP and said that with its passage, there will be a significant reduction in generic competition, which means that there will be an extreme increase in global prices for cancer drugs, as well as like just basic drugs for flus and like fever research. So the impact here is one. Disease and cancer. The little A here is that HIV and AIDS medicines around the world were $60 and falling due to generic competition. It was simply just the fact that the patents were expiring and they had the ability to be competitive, which pushed prices down, which means that when you stop the ability for competition, you will increase the prices. The little B here is that this will allow them to repatent AIDS medication, which will allow them to increase the prices on these drugs, meaning that people will have less access to this medication. Additionally, there's cancer drugs in the United States and they will be able to extend their patents, meaning that they can not only jump up the prices, but they will be able to lock them in for several periods of time due to the fact that they will have unlimited ability to continue their patents. The second impact is going to be death. It is that there's preventable suffering that will be prolonged because people won't have access to medicine. This will specifically hurt economically disadvantaged people who won't be able to afford this. And since it does affect Medicare and Medicaid, it will hurt these populations as well. What we hear is that this is damning for places without medical infrastructure. There are several countries in this agreement that don't have the necessary hospital infrastructure that it would take to be able to get quick access to medicine, which means that they're never going to be able to cure diseases and not die when they shouldn't be dying. Disadvantaged group. DHS policies. AZ Meekness won in December. The 113th Congress passed an obvious funding bill to extend the funding for the government through most of 2015, but congressional Republicans set the funding for the Department of Homeland Security to expire on February 27th in order to use the DHS funding to reveal Obama's executive orders loosening immigration standards. Speaker John Boehner announced earlier this week that the House GOP was releasing a bill this weekend which would extend the funding for DHS. The second is that the DHS funding bill currently will not include amendments to the repeal of the immigration reform. However, this agreement is tenuous. Is that moderate Republicans, such as Republican Pete King, have pushed Boehner not to include the amendments in fear that the bill will stall. The bill here is that the pressure is currently on Boehner. The recent attacks in Paris and Louis Boehner to indicate that he will separate the bills. However, he has still indicated that the DHS funding is a political tool for the GOP. The B is that the length the plan passes and moderate Republicans pushes moderate Republicans away from cooperating with Democrats, which means that it forces moderation to switch positions and align with leadership to counterbalance the Obama win. The second is that plan anchors Boehner. Little A is that this is hijacking the agenda. Boehner views the agenda as
it's his political tool.
Yeah, it's his political tool, and basically they're hijacking the agenda, which makes it so that they can't do this. Passing the TPA pushes this on their plate, means that they don't have the ability because it puts a time frame on Congress. Sees the internal links. One is that Boehner will reattach immigration amendments to the DHS funding, meaning that since this is critical to pass, it will be riding on it. The second is that immigration riders will kill DHS funding bill, so it won't be passing. The latest is that the Democrats will backlash in the Senate not passing this vote. The little B is that Obama will veto it because he has said that he will veto anything with immigration riders. The third argument is that DHS funding will expire. The little A is that now is key because we need to focus and pressure with the passing of terrorism. We need to be passing the risk of certain attacks, and without this funding, we have no ability to combat this. And little B is that one delay hurts the DHS operations. The director of the DHS said that he declares that there's uncertainty in the funding that will prevent the DHS from maintaining projects and accurately locating funds, which means that they're never going to have the ability to continue their operations as it leads to the impacts of, one, an increase in terrorism. Right now, we are holding ISIS. They are not being able to expand because of these attacks. Without the ability to carry out these operations in this region, it only leads to their expansion. And ISIS is going to be uniquely bad because they specifically hurt rights of women in the area, as well as killing people just for not following the same sect of religion that they do, which means that there's going to be oppression in this area. Additionally, the scenario, too, is that you're going to have an ally I freaked out a little bit. Is that recent terrorist attacks in France caused President Obama to pledge on to stopping to pledge support onto this? The little B is that the failure to actually pledge the support and to follow through means that you're actually going to be killing our ability to do this, and you're going to be hurting the hedge. So the little three here is that you're never going to get access to the impacts of your second advantage when you destroy hedge, when we don't have the ability to carry out our military operations and hold true to what we're actually doing. Going on the case. Going on to the background. First off, TPA is not going to be inevitable. It's been held off this long. Obama has been asking for it since he was put into office because he's been trying to pass the TPP. There's absolutely no reason. Additionally, Republicans have pledged that without support from the Democrats, they're never going to be passing the TPA and that they're not going to be giving this to Obama. There's absolutely no reason why this would happen. Additionally, you say this is at the top of the docket, but that is simply not true. The top of the docket is the DHS bill, budget bills, and the medical device tax, which is these are all the pressing issues that are coming up. There's absolutely no reason why this has been on the docket. It's been talked about for a long time, but we've gone about 6 years without them actually doing this. Advantage one. Alright. First on advantage one. First off, we're going to see that SUV sales have actually been skyrocketing in the status quo because of the recent drop in gas prices. They've been able to sell more cars, which means that there's absolutely no reason why the auto industry is declining. Additionally, we would say turn that, you create jobs in the U.S., but we would say turn because of the labor conditions. You can look to NAFTA, where we allow corporations to undersell local producers and push out other products. You can specifically look to the corn market in Mexico after NAFTA. We flooded the market with, cheaper things, which means that if you increase the manufacturing in the U.S., we'll flood other countries with it, which pushes out local producers and local manufacturing plants, which leads to an increase in prices and an increase in poverty. You can look to the fact that in Mexico after NAFTA, their poverty line increased over to 12%, which means that you're only going to be hurting this and re-entrenching the system of violence without the ability for them to ever solve this back, which turns the entirety of this advantage. Additionally, on their internal links, you can turn this down. Okay, advantage. Going to the power strip. You can cross-apply a lot of this advantage. This is going to be solving this. Additionally, we would say that the U.S. image is probably going to be pretty high right now, considering we've been doing a good job at keeping other at keeping countries at bay like ISIS.
Let's go advantage two. Then the politics percent. Then this, the first percent. And then the rest of the case murder.
That having trade agreements with multiple nations actually helps us with power projection, then the United States would just decide to not fund the DHS. The second area where we're winning is that free trade is always going to be good for everyone in the world, which the free trade helps liberalization, that helps edge against corporations from screwing over other people on power projection. I was going to extend the entirety of this advantage. They simply don't get to this with enough time. They just said cross-apply the disadvantage of the U.S. Perceptions high now, but they move the entirety. Do you ever have any this question? This means that specifically we're winning the link arguments that mean that we have guaranteed the increased alliances due to dependencies, but additionally how the trade alliances transfer over into military alliances. Additionally, I want you to extend our argument how this is key to specifically protecting the Malacca Straits.
Okay.
You want something?
Yeah, they say that the U.S. image is high. It's high in the Middle East right now. It's not high in Asia, which is where this is happening.
But
feel left out.
But additionally, even though we're projecting power in the Middle East right now, that doesn't mean that we that we have good perception globally, especially given the embarrassment we gave you on how Obama had to visit China to dislodge revelations or additionally
all of our unit is specific to that question. On politics, but we're not just going to not fund the DHS. All right.
On politics, first of all, there's no reason for Republicans to backlash against something controversially controversially like this, but specifically because everybody's already too busy posturing for 2016 to be petty about something like this. But the second argument is that Obama and the GOP agree on this one, which means that there's only a minority in the Democrat Party people like Harry Reid who would actually go against them. But he doesn't. But Harry Reid is who was the main opponent of trade promotion authority previously, also the reason why trade promotion authority didn't get passed, to answer your point in the background. But specifically, Harry Reid spearheaded the opposition here. He's no longer Senate Majority Leader. He's going to be more concerned with taking back the Senate than going against something that Obama stands for. It's probably the reason why he's not going to want to he's not going to sacrifice it for that. Additionally,
you can also cross-apply all of my arguments about why GOP likes this, because it creates manufacturer jobs, businesses. Obama likes this.
Additionally, I want you to cross-apply the arguments from the PMC that talk about why the GOP specifically likes this, because it creates manufacturing jobs and the GOP's restriction being on the free trade line, but additionally on why Obama's been asking for the trade promotion authority as well. They're just going to come up here and say that the plan will push moderate GOP's way because they won't want to work with Obama, but they historically have, over the past several years, they've been pushing for this. And now that Harry Reid's essentially no longer Senate Majority Leader, it means that there's not as much opposition there. But additionally, on the internal links, first argumentation is if they were to put immigration riders on it at all, it would probably just go back to committee and be rewritten. They wouldn't just not fund the DHS. That's kind of nonsensical. The next argumentation is that the DHS, not the DOD, means that they would not be, we still have a ridiculously well-funded Department of Defense to be able to take on ISIS. Additionally, we solve for ally freakout. If we were to fall out of the trade agreement, or if we were to not actually come through with things on the TPP or the TPIP, or the TTIP, then that is when allies freak out, and the World War II plan doesn't pass.
Alright. On TPP.
First argumentation is going to be turned to the free trade levels of playing field for corporations for other people. It means that corporations actually have to sell things fairly to all countries under the same restrictions. Argumentation is that even if the TPP has bad things in it, this is only a move towards more and more free trade agreements, because if anyone would have the ability to fast track more trade agreements, this means that there would only be more free trade agreements, and the regional trade blocs would only expand until we move closer and closer towards global free trade. This always creates a scenario which is more preferable, because right now the status quo, corporations can still screw people over anyways when they have individual free trade agreements with countries. The next argumentation is going to be turned that corporations won't have much leverage when they're dealing with multiple countries at once, because they will have because when they're making trade agreements with large regional trade blocs, this means that they would have to try to make the same deals with multiple different countries, and they won't be able to just pick on one country or pick them out individually and see what their particular weakness is or who they can sell drugs to at what prices. But the third argument here is going to be turned that there's but additionally they have less leverage because they're dealing with larger bodies. A corporation that's dealing with a smaller developing country always has has much more leverage because they have more power relative to them. They don't have as much power relative to large trading blocks, which means that they can't negotiate those kind of deals in the future, which means that even if they're going to come back and they're going to talk about how the TPP has specific provisions in it, but argumentation here is that that the plan always moves closer towards free trade, and the closer we move towards global free trade, the more disempowered corporations are to do this thing in the future. Corporations screw people over on drug prices right now. This is something that happens in the status quo. The only way to get rid of that is to try to level the playing field. And absent a counterplan or any argumentation as to why in the status quo corporations are all of a sudden going to stop screwing people over on drug prices, this is the only way to stop it. The plan is the only way to actually fix the systemic problem. So they're only identifying one instance in the future of how this would continue to happen, but that's the norm for corporations right now. Additionally, This, they say that cuts would decrease access to medicine. Our argumentation is going to be turned that without free trade, there simply is no access to medicine. But the next argumentation is turned to liberalization is always going to present that they're conceding arguments on why it increases the standard of living and why it increases the purchasing power of nations that are involved in free trade agreements. It probably means that that this only way for them to actually get medicine to begin with. But the next argumentation is going to be turned that non-free trade agreements are always going to be subject to tariffs and protectionism, which will always have a strong lobby from things like pharmaceutical companies. If you're doing one-on-one deals between nations and not trying to establish large regional trade blocks in which free trade occurs, then the free trade lobby only has to say go to Congress the pharmaceutical lobby then just goes to Congress and says, hey, in this deal that you're making with Bolivia, let's say, why don't you jack up the drug prices a little bit? They have much more ability to do that when there are bilateral trades. They can't do that in multilateral trades because they have to make the conditions same for multiple nations. On the background, they say that the TPA is not inevitable right now. I want you to extend our argumentation on why Orrin Hatch wants it and why Obama wants it. And additionally, I want you to cross-apply the argumentation you made on Pocus and why Harry Reid was made in opposition to it. Now he's not in power anymore. But additionally, even if Harry Reid does have a lot of clout, they'll be more concerned with trying to win the Senate back and try to keep the Democrat Party together after the major loss that they just had in the elections than trying to go against Obama. Probably the reason why it will manufacture. They say this, the auto sales are going up because gas prices are down, but they're ignoring argumentation on how they had three straight months of drops, but additionally how they had a 1.3% drop last quarter. They're not this is an interesting word, but it's simply not interacting with our empirics. But additionally, the argument where they say terms that NAFTA NAFTA corporations will undersell and flood other markets. Our argumentation is that free trade is key to specifically stopping this because it essentially levels the playing field and makes it so that people that you can't artificially inflate prices or essentially screw around with the market like that. It's probably key to being able to stop this in the long term. Free trade is key to stopping that. Yeah.
Alright, starting with the bread. The medical access to SAD, so the first to SAD, then politics to SAD, and case. So you have background, advantage one, advantage two. Extend the argument that corporations are inevitably going to jack up prices in case there's no reason to why free trade and trade will ever be able to resolve this. But even if they try to go with the terms here, you can extend the argument to say that the free trade agreements extend the ability perhaps to utilize in order to as a mechanism in order to be able to take away from to raise the prices and be able to extend the length of patents so that generic drugs can't be created in case of right and why medical access is going to inevitably be taken away regardless of the way the free trade agreements and free trade agreements work, which means if you're not going to this position, they don't get an impact. Politics. The MG tries to lap off this dissent. However, they concede a lot of nuance to the story. There are three things that you need to know. First, that Boehner is utilizing the Department of Homeland Security funding as a political tool in order to force Obama to make hard decisions to be able to revoke the immigration executive orders they made in December. But also the second thing you need to know is that Boehner is the man here, that Boehner is controlled not only of the agenda, but that Boehner is the one that's going to do this much backlash in this scenario. It means all of the arguments that they're making about Republicans that are not going to backlash doesn't matter. Additionally, the third thing you need to know is that this disadvantage is going to outweigh not only the terrorism arguments that go straight into it, additionally the disadvantage Jack Turner's case. And we were waiting the arguments that recent attacks have led President Obama to specifically pledge support on anti-terrorism, and then we go ahead and turn our backs and cut the Department of Homeland Security. It's an indication why allies are not going to trust the United States in the future. It means that this is going to lead to allies and allies moving away from the United States in favor of other security guarantees. It's an indication why this is going to go on this economic growth. The first argument that makes that Republicans aren't going to backlash controversially against us because of the fact that they're hedging for 2016. However, the first argument is that they're utilizing the DHS funding to set up the 2016 elections. This is exactly how they are doing it. The bill that they are currently working on is one that would extend DHS funding, but would also repeal the immigration executive orders that Obama made. It's an indication why Boehner is utilizing this politically in order to be able to take away, in order to put Obama on the wrong side of this, and that's going to be able to remove a lot of the Obama policies. But additionally, the second argument is that this doesn't make sense. Is that this just isn't being listed for previous empirics about how Republicans have shut down the government in the past. They would shut this down. They have shut down the government for their political reasons. Indication why they would follow the policy wrong threats. The next argument makes that there's only a minority of Democrats that are against the TPA, versus that we don't care about that Democrats are not key to this discussion. That Boehner is the one that's been that setting the agenda, and Boehner is the one that is one backlash against this. Specifically, Boehner using the agenda is the key tool for him to be able to win, for the Republicans to win the 2016 elections. You click that Boehner is utilizing this to not only take away parts of people who care. That is appealing to the base. You can list the fact that it's a week that the House has voted on a bill that would change the mechanism by which the Affordable Care Act is determined to change from a 30-hour work week to a 40-hour work week. It's an indication of how they are utilizing the agenda offensively. In addition, you can list the fact that the first bill that the Senate passed was one that would take away the authority to approve Keystone XL away from President Obama. It's an indication why the agenda uniquely and how the Clinton office would be extreme, be taking the agenda away from Boehner, and thus would break down this necessary coalition. Additionally, this would lead to harm to worse harms in the future. Additionally, the next argument they make is that the GOP likes the TPA. It doesn't matter. First, this argument doesn't matter because of the fact that even if a certain number of Republicans like TPA, Boehner doesn't is an indication why this argument doesn't function. Additionally, second is that it doesn't matter about what the specific bill is. They could be passing a bill that would give a puppy to everyone in America. It wouldn't matter. The agenda is what is important here. The taking of the agenda away from Boehner as the political tool, the only political tool he has, is a reason to why he had backlash.
They don't like it because it gives them more power, and that makes them look back for the election.
Additionally, if you look to the analysis that Grace is giving me out of the LLC, that it looks like it's an Obama win. They are trying to take everything away from Obama and his status quo. You can look to the fact that in the last election cycle, it was a major priority to cause Obama to lose. You can look to the fact that they almost didn't have the debt ceiling in order to be able to put Obama on the wrong side of this. This was an indication why not only would they extend this into the future, because of the fact that they made huge wins in the midterm, but additionally, that this is an indication of how they believe these tactics and these strategies work. The next argument that makes that moderates work with Obama, this argument doesn't matter. All of our arguments are about the agenda and how Boehner specifically key. The next argument that makes that the immigration writers are put on is just going to go back to committee first, is that the deadline is February 27th. This is an indication of how they're not going to be able to get a bill together in time. It's an indication of why this would not function. Additionally, second, you need to stand across the analysis that Grace gives you from the head of the Secretary of the Department of Homeland Security and says that any major delays are going to prevent or even are going to hamstring the ability of the Department of Homeland Security to actually create better policy. You can look to the fact that it prevents them from being able to not only allocate money appropriately, but additionally prevents them from starting new projects. It's an indication of why this, but even if there's not a collapse in the Department of Homeland Security, we still get access to all of our analysis about how the DHS becomes effective. But the DHS is not DOD, and that would still take on ISIS. Okay, yeah, that's fair. However, you listen to the analysis says the Department of Homeland Security is still necessary in order to be able to check back against things like terrorist attacks, because that not only do they maybe place things like such as Coast Guard, but additionally the fact that they do things such as doing like customs and enforcement, making sure that there's not bombs on planes. All of these things are the Department of Homeland Security is an indication of why it's necessary to be able to check back from terrorist attack, an indication of why this would be a risk attack. The next argument that makes that is that how is everyone freaked out of the plan? Or this is exactly where our time frame arguments function. They say that free trade agreements are going to allow for we to have better allies in the future. However, if we right now cut back on our terrorism funding right after a major terrorist attack in Paraguay, one of our major NATO allies, these are reasons why allies would not trust the United States. This means we outweigh on time frame question, and it's turned the imperative to their advantage too. So reasons why you're going to be firing the affirmative. The only other arguments I want you to send here on the impact level that says this risk of this release or risk of terrorist attack is what has resulted in the case that not only would a lot of people die as a result of this, because about the moment of the attack itself, to suggest additionally that the United States would necessarily retaliate, to further attacks, damage to the status quo, which is the excellent example here, that when there was an attack on the United States, that led to not to invade two different countries, and led to the deaths of hundreds of thousands of individuals, and indications why this impact would double. On that note. Okay, this TPA inevitable, not inevitable debate really doesn't matter. The only thing that we need to win is that TPA is not going to pass right now. There's an indication for why the DHS funding would pass even if TPA is inevitable. There's a reason why none of this argumentation matters. The only thing that I want to deal with here is they say the TPA is popular because of the fact that they cite one individual having come to the fact that the agenda is key is a reason why Republicans are willing to bring it up in their own time frame is an indication why not only would this be a reason why this would probably take away a lot of the affirmative offense because of the fact that TPA is inevitable and there's no reason to pass it now. But additionally, it's a reason why politics decides now is going to keep on a man's one. It says that manufacturing and auto sales are increasing in the status quo. They make the argument that there were 3 months of drops, however, but gas prices have been decreasing over only the last month. It's also an indication why RKR war is better because of the fact that because gas prices are on the effect, auto sales over a lagging period of time. That while gas prices decrease, it means that individuals see that and it means they're more likely to buy vehicles. However, that happens over a lagging period of time, which means that while gas prices are low now, it means that they're good. It means that auto sales will increase over the next several months. It's an indication why. All the argumentation about manufacturing is not key. Additional second argument says this is going to be this leads to worse labor conditions. And when the United States taking advantage of other countries, you are not the worst example about how NAFTA was utilized in our to sell corn at an extremely cheap rate in Mexico, led to the establishment of a major decrease in labor standards. All you're asked about why our country is good, but not matter. All right.
It's going to be. The disadvantage. Alright, it takes 6 in. And then it's going to be advantage 2. And then the background and the advantage. With a bit of an overview. Negative team winning this one, they laugh off the politics disadvantage from the start. This is going to be problematic because it turns the entirety of their advantage 2, and with it turns on advantage 1, all the impacts are going to be outweighing in our favor. Go on to the disadvantage. You can stand across all the arguments that Baker is the one that's key, that it's going to look like we were hijacking the agenda. When you force the TPA on them with time constrictions, it means that you are taking the agenda away, which is inherently going to make Baker backlash. You can extend across all of our warrants. They simply don't do enough here. They just make assertions how the Obama and the GOP are working together, but you can look to the warrants that we're giving you that are saying that this is not going to be winning and that the GOP doesn't want this because it looks like a win for Obama. When you extend across all of these things and you see that the precedent proves that the GOP never wants to give Obama a win, when this looks like they're giving Obama a win, they will always push against it. And Boehner is the key element here. They do not respond to the fact that Boehner is the key element. They instead try to go that the Republican base isn't going to rally entirely. This is not the argument, or this is the argument that's coming out of the MG, which means that you're not going to allow them answers with the PMR about how Boehner isn't key, because our whole argument since the start was that Boehner is key. They do not respond to this. You can extend across all of the points that the agenda is what matters here, and all of their responses are non-responsive. They talk about Harry Reid and Obama and the GOP, but none of this matters whatsoever because it is a hyper-specific scenario talking about Boehner. They don't respond to this. They have no way out of this link because they don't respond to it coming out of the MG. Additionally, you can extend across that they're going to attach immigration riders. They never respond to the time frame that is saying that February 27th is the deadline for pulling all of DHS funding. They don't respond to the timeline, which means that their argument saying that this will go back to committee is the exact reason why we would see that huge ally freak out that they are trying to solve. This means that they don't actually get access to this. When they say that this will be ally freak out, they're not going to be able to win this argument because they don't respond to the time frame that we're going to be pulling this. You can extend across the fact that when we pull back operations, allies are never going to be trusting us and they're not actually going to be able to do this, which means that we get access to all the impacts and the turn on their disadvantage. They're never going to be able to create more hegemony and more connections when we don't have the ability to fight. follow through on what we've already promised or what we think that we're going to be promising.
That was a magnitude probability.
Yeah, this completely outweighs our magnitude probability when you can look to the fact that terrorist attacks are terrorist attacks will rise when you see the lack of ability for us to check this back, which causes our allies to run away from us because we don't have the ability to protect them and do what we promised, which means that it is a straight turn to advantage too, and the impacts are always going to be pulling back. They don't answer the hyperspecificity of this argument. There's no way for them to go on anything. Additionally, they have zero offense on this disadvantage, which means that any risk of the disadvantage, it turns advantage two, means there's no way out for them. Go with the DA. Going on to advantage two. Okay. Just went down to the impact level where they try to say that they're going to be solving for the power projection. There's no ability to power project. They never answer back. Like, they're going to go for power projection, but they never answer back the fact that you can't power project if you can't hold true to your word. They never answer any of these arguments, which means that the advantage to you is turned by the disadvantage.
We also have to go on the time frame because these trade agreements take a long time for us.
Yeah, we all have a time frame. They can't even answer to when the TCIP is actually going to pass because it's going to be a long time, months down the road. We're talking February 27th here, which means that this is going to happen immediately and you have no room to for error here. So one error could be extremely costly. Going on to the background. Like Corey said, none of this actually matters. All we have to win is that this isn't going to happen before February 27th. You can extend across all of the bills that we said are at the top of the docket, which are at the top of the docket right now. TPA hasn't been happening. There's no indication about why it would actually happen. Obama's been asking for this for years, and it hasn't happened, which means that you're not going to be, they're not going to be able to go for time frame on the TPA because the reality is the TPA takes a long time, but pushing DHS funding will happen right now. It's the only immediate impact. Going on to advantage one. Except across the fact that the S&P sales are rising as of last month, all of their warrants are 3 months old, which means that you're going to be performing our warrants, showing that manufacturers are going to be going up in this quote regardless. Additionally, this makes worse labor conditions in other countries. They never answer this back. They just say U.S. You're going to be looking to the fact that it hurts other countries, and it just hurts other workers in other areas, causing more poverty in third world countries.
Flex.
So the government shut down?
What? Yeah, it did. The GOP shut down a bit ago.
Did it reopen?
Yeah, not without economical damage though.
Oh, cool. What economical damage was that?
There was rising inflation rates, there was investor freak out in the stock market.
Yeah, shut down.
And I mean,
have you ever like come to a deadline for, I don't know, the debt limit and stuff like that?
Sorry for what?
The debt ceiling. Have you ever like come to pressing deadlines with that kind of stuff?
Yeah. We've pressed very close.
Yeah.
Have we ever extended that deadline?
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
yeah.
Cool.
This doesn't apply to
we've never gone over the debt ceiling, right? Like, we never hit the debt ceiling.
I mean,
sure,
that's
but
fine.
This doesn't apply to DHS.
It doesn't work.
Yeah, it's two different issues.
Okay, that's fine. We're just having a less than civic engagement thing. That's all. I just wanted to ask some questions.
Less
than
civic engagement.
Okay. We're gonna go. Let's go advantage one. Actually, no. Sorry, advantage two, advantage one. Because the idea that the Republican Party would put the Department of Homeland Security, which is in charge of stopping terrorism, in danger in any way is absolutely ridiculous. On the Advantage 2. If you're going to be flowing across the entirety of the Advantage 2, there is no arguments against this except that the disadvantage turns this. When we get to the disadvantage and explain how this does not affect our power projection whatsoever, that is going to show how we get the entirety of the second advantage, which include the impacts about checking back against stopping a closure of a strait that accounts for three times of the tanker traffic of the Suez Canal, five times of that of the Panama Canal, as well as one quarter of the world's oil. That is always going to have massive
massive amounts of repercussions are going to go across the entirety of the globe, and especially when you account for two-thirds of the world population that lives on less than a dollar a day. When food prices increase because of this, it's always going to create a massive issue. Look, there's only a couple of arguments that we need here. The first argument that we need here is they're trying to say that a lot of our statistics is 3 months old. The third statistic underneath that says that they missed sales by over 1 million units at the end of December is definitely not 3 months old, and they're just talking about SUVs. We're talking about auto manufacturing as a whole. Sure, SUVs have been going up, but auto manufacturing as a whole hasn't been going down. The next argument under here is that even if we grant that, this is still a linear disad as a whole. This creates an increase in manufacturing exports. We win the internal scenario about how that increases jobs. Jobs are pretty important for the reason that we articulated. The last argument that I go for on here is the term that this is going to screw over other countries. You can pull across Patrick's argument about how free trade is specifically going to be key stopping this, because when you have free global trade, that is always going to be checking back against people trying to take advantage of other countries. The next argument I need over here is that this is a term free trade creates an increase in quality of life, wages, etc., because there is more goods being produced, there's more goods being exported, as we explained in the internal scenario. And the second argument over here is that term free trade prevents dumping, and because it specifically levels the playing field. When you have free trade, it doesn't allow specific countries, like in bilateral trade agreements, to like screw over other specific countries. Overview. There is no reason why Boehner would put his entire Republican 2016 election in jeopardy by screwing over the Department of Homeland Security, especially when it means that he would also be screwing over immigration reform, two things that the Republican Party need in order to be in any effect competitive in the 2016 election. The first argument I want to go for under here is going to be the most important argument, which is the fact that this is the Department of Homeland Security. Last time I checked, France is not in the homeland. This does not affect how we respond to France terrorism whatsoever. It means that our allies don't freak out. All it means is that there's a slightly more increased possibility of a terrorist attack in the United States. But the next argument under here is that the people who fear the terrorist attack in the United States more than anybody else is the Republican Party, which is just going to show why this is incredibly not probable. But the next argument under here is that Boehner really puts immigration riders on the bill, it will just go back to committee. That is an argument that Patrick puts on there, but there's no way does anyone vote for a budget that defunds the Department of Homeland Security. There's no way that the Department of Homeland Security is going to be taken apart, but even if Boehner does do this, no one is specifically going to side with him. He's incredible. He's already fighting a popularity battle.
Sorry, it's going up a little bit, but the argument that the Department of Homeland Security doesn't affect France and thus France doesn't care is an argument that could have been in the MG and is new in the speech.
That I have that as your response to our DOD is going to be able to, in like, our argument is that the DOD, that comes out of Patrick's speech, is the DOD is going to be able to keep power projection up abroad. You respond by saying, no, France just had a terrorist attack, pulling the DHS is going to freak them out. We're rearticulating that the DOD is what handles the terrorist attack in France, not the Department of Homeland Security. Once again, Boehner's already fighting a popularity battle. Right now, there's no way that he would defund something that is one of the linchpins of the Republican Party and one of the linchpins of their platform. Their entire platform is that we need to stop terrorism in the United States. They are terrified. That is why they want to shut down flights from everywhere every chance they get on the impact calculus. The first argument is we're going to be winning a probability. You can flow across the entirety of Advantage 2, but you can also flow across the entirety of the internal links on Advantage 1. We tell you that increased manufacturing would happen post-plan. That is always going to lead to an increase in jobs. But the next argument is that they are not going to be winning a probability. There is no probability that the GOP is going to be defunding the Department of Homeland Security. But on top of that, the entire linchpin of that disadvantage is that allied confidence goes down when power projection decreases. Power projection does not decrease unless the DOD decreases. You do not show how the DOD decreases one bit, we might have an increased chance of terrorist attack for a couple seconds in the United States, but that's the answer.
Yeah, compare that with our inability to make bases when we don't pass things like TTIP.
Yeah, and compare that with the inability to put bases on other countries when we don't have trade agreements with them. The next argument under here is we're also going to be winning on reversibility. There is always a chance, like we've seen every single time, whenever there's a shutdown, we just go and make a budget a couple weeks later. If we shut down the DHS, we're just going to reopen it a couple weeks later. There's no way that impact is going to create any bad.
something negative, but I'm really not happy with the way this debate goes down at all. So I'll kind of talk about it a little bit. The reason I end up voting negative is I think a lot of the PMR strategy on this disad is new in a way. Like, it's not necessarily coherent with the MG strategy. The MG strategy is all Republicans actually like this, not gonna happen. And then the PMR strategy is a lot just like, this wouldn't happen, it would just get funded back later, etc. That's not super responsive to Corey's arguments in the MRL. While I do think that, like, in my mind, like, personally, that's probably true, I don't think it's responsive to the arguments that come out in the MO. And I think that just voting for them because I think they're true and I think this dissent is stupid is something I'm tempted to do, but something I can't feel comfortable doing. So I can talk about all of the pages a little more specifically, but that's how it comes down. So let's talk about the background sheet first. I think that this needs to be in the debate for the AFF, because your arguments are that right now the GOP is giving Obama trade promotion authority. If the GOP is giving Obama trade promotion authority now, and you go for that argument, like, it doesn't matter because it doesn't take any of the whatever docket control or whatever away from Boehner or away from the Republicans, because they're giving him that in the status quo. So that argument, I think, gets you out of the disad 100% for the most part. I think that argument needs to be extended. And that's the reason, anytime you have those arguments in the background, that's why they're there, because they're gonna end up being important for things like this. I think in terms of the manufacturing advantage, you guys need more work here. Like, their statistics are just, their statistics do a lot more work than this intuitive argument about gas prices. I also think you guys should make the argument that gas prices are uncertain. People aren't gonna buy a freaking Land Rover because gas prices are $1.98 today, because they could be $3 in, you know, a month or so, and that Land Rover's already pretty expensive. So I think there are definitely arguments that you can make against that, just so they don't have to extend it in the future. It doesn't do anything, it doesn't matter, because I think you guys win this advantage anyway, I just don't think it ends up mattering. And then I also don't think that this free trade agreements are bad, no level playing field, we screwed over Mexico argument. It doesn't, if you're gonna go for it, you need to be more responsive to the arguments that they're making, because a giant portion of the MG is just actually, if we have a bunch of free trade agreements, which is what happens in the world of the AFF, this all gets resolved. I think in the PMC, there needs to be a lot more time spent on the impact level of this debate, because on advantage two, you don't really get anywhere on advantage two, which makes it a little bit tricky. And quite frankly, advantage one doesn't get, like, the impact level on advantage one is pretty faint also. So just spend more time there, because that can help you later also. Okay, I think advantage two pretty much just comes down to the disad. It's a question of whether or not the disad outweighs advantage two for the most part, because that's what everyone's going for. So I wish that you guys would not have gone for this disad, because I think that, I mean, while the other disad involves more explaining the nuances of free trade agreements, I think it's smarter, because I think that there are a lot of ways they can get out of this disad super easily, and yeah. So I think that the arguments that need to be made in the PMR on this disad are, you need to first of all explain why the GOP liking the plan outweighs any kind of these agenda links, because you're just right, it's not the Republicans that have any problem with trade promotion authority. The Republicans love trade promotion authority, because then they can pass a bunch of trade deals that corporations like and manufacturing likes and all of that stuff. And I know that they're trying to, in the MO, be like, ooh, it doesn't matter who likes it, it's just all about stealing the agenda. I think it does still matter who likes it. Like, I don't think that gets out of your arguments, because if it's an agenda that's super dope for you, like, it doesn't matter that maybe someone else passed something. So I think that that needs to be more of the strategy, and then that argument that I already talked about on the background piece of paper. Also, like, if they're gonna claim that any passing anything would disrupt this legislation, like, talk about that also, because something is certainly going to pass before, what, February 29th or something like that. But I mean, I think you're correct to make these intuitive arguments. I just think they're not coherent with the MG, and kind of, you know, but I mean, I think you're right. So, okay, I think that the arguments specifically, well, okay, I don't know, I can go through all the specific arguments, but I think they're answered back by arguments in the the LOC. The argument about the DHS and France and all of that stuff is answered back by the LOC, where they say that allies would freak out because Obama pledged just support to combat terrorism and then we open all of our ports. Yeah, the DOD still exists other places, but if we no longer have a DHS and all of our ports are open, then people are definitely going to sneak into our ports, whatever, and that makes the U.S. look pretty bad because then things happen like we invade other countries, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, that argument about Republicans fear terrorism the most, that's new. Your argument about how Boehner would put riders so we would just go back, their deadline argument answers this. No one would side with him. Corey's making a bunch of arguments about why it's just Boehner and that's all that matters. So yeah, all of those arguments I think are answered back. But yeah, I would just go for a different design because I think you're going to get your butts handed to you on some point on this.
That's fair.
I just am not the biggest fan of it because I don't think it makes a lot of sense. But that's okay. Good job to everyone. Anyone have any questions?
Do you have any like personal feedback for like?
Yeah, I think we can improve on.
Yeah, like at the individual level, like things.
Let me see if I wrote down anything before the AOC. I try to write my comments down in purple, but then I always end up losing them. I think one big one is in a world where you're not going to read a counterplan, you definitely need more work on case. Because that just puts you in a not so good position. Also, if I find the rest of my comments, when you're reading a politics dissent like this that has a bunch of like, and also like immigration reform mixed in with DHS, mixed in with like these stories that don't, like the dissent doesn't make inherent like intuitive sense because everyone is like, Republicans love this, why are you reading this? In that situation, I think it needs to be more maybe slowly explained and more structured. It comes out a little bit like takes me a second to process it, which I think when you're reading a politics dissent that isn't intuitive, it's more helpful to be slow and have it be super structured and maybe even explain it at the bottom.
Yeah, like an
which
interview.
Which is kind of stupid, but I think in these situations perhaps prevents you from having someone not understand at all what's going on.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, so from a strategy perspective, we had talked about just not reading politics and then just straight turning hedge.
Yeah.
Do you think that would have been a better approach?
I mean, I guess in the end.
Probably.
I mean, from an LLC standpoint.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. I mean, I really don't like politics on this topic.
That's fair.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, the link story doesn't make sense.